Hello, everybody. Hello. We all belong here and we deserve to dream. Yeah. Sandra, I've been admiring your puppies all week, and they look so cute. I just couldn't quite believe they were real. So I just pinned you, and they are real, aren't they? They're not toys. They just look so archetypally cute.
Yeah, they're very real. Thank you.
Thanks for, thanks for sharing them with us all through the
Thank you.
week. Yeah, welcome everybody. Yeah, welcome here. So, we've got a I mean I woke up this morning. I must say I did feel quite a tinge of sadness actually. I've kind of grown into this retreat, you know, over the days we've been together, and I've been increasingly warming to it and got into a kind of little routine and things. So yeah, I'm personally feeling a little bit sad that we're coming to the end. So I just run through the schedule for this session. So it's quite full. We're going to start with an arriving practice, and then a few people left the retreat this morning, and we had a Dharma appeal, and no doubt possibly if this will be some people's last session today. So Zach is going to zoom down, all being well, and do a short Dharma appeal for Buddhist Center online. And then yeah, we've got a little bit of space to recap on the retreat. So we've been through many different landscapes and explored many different angles of practice and shared a lot and explored a lot. So the team are going to try and give three headlines each for what we hope for you to take away from the retreat, three things that we feel important. We're going to follow that with not a Q&A. The team don't want to be under the pressure of having answers, but we have a question and response. So if you do want to if there's anything around the input of the retreat and your own practice, around the input of the retreat and your own practice that you'd like some clarification on or comment or some response, then some have already come in on the Padlet, but do feel free to pop them in the chat, and we'll harvest them. We're getting very skilled at harvesting now. We're skilled harvesters, and then by the time we come to the Q&R later on in the session, we're hoping we've got them organized, and we'll sort of run through them. Yeah, if you we're going to then come on to later in the day, later in this session, we're going to have breakout rooms. So in fact, I had a request from Tech Central that if you don't want to be in a breakout room, could you let Zach know? It just really helps him in his job, you know, just to know some way in advance. Sometimes, you know, just before we're about to go into groups, it can happen that there's a kind of snowstorm of people wanting to change, and you know, you look up and you see the tech guy slightly kind of frozen, a bit overwhelmed. So yeah, if you could let Zach know in advance, that would be great. And then yeah, we'll take a break. And I just wanted to just ask just my co-hosts, is there anything else that you wanted to say about this session? No, good. Good. So let's do some arriving practice. So we've done quite a lot of arriving practices. So How about with this arriving practice, it's just free form. So you can just spend the next few minutes, the invitation is just spend the next few minutes sensing, however I am now, what do I feel might resource me best? Or do I need a little bit more energy? Do I need to rest? Do I need to bring some movement to my shoulders? Do I need to get a glass of water? So yeah, we'll just have a 5 minutes stretching, whatever you feel you might need to do. Okay, good. So now hopefully we're a little bit more alive to welcome Zach, who's gonna pin himself with kindness. Welcome, Zach. Maybe we can
Great.
all say hello to Zach. He's not often on the spotlight. Been working hard in the background there, and yeah, the
Intense seeing so much waving at you. It's quite a weird experience,
last. Do you need some arriving practice now?
actually. I was gonna say I was doing breakout groups, so I wasn't doing any arriving practice. Yeah, no, that's really good. Thanks, Balajit. Yeah, I'm aware that many of you will have heard a little bit of a pitch earlier, so I'll try not to keep you too long. I was thinking earlier, it's actually because I went for a walk over lunchtime, and I said it does actually feel very much like there is a retreat on at the at Dharma Track, a Dharma Tracker. That doesn't necessarily, that might not necessarily feel like how it might feel for you. It's quite a lot more work. But I do really enjoy it, actually. I always we me and Daiketi were saying this the earlier, it's like a we sort of yeah, it is more work, but also it is very sort of nourishing, and it is we benefit from it as well. So I sort of want to sort of thank people. Well, it's not sort of, I definitely want to thank people for coming along, because like I benefit from this as well, and so that's really good. And I just really appreciate the kind comments and that people have put in the chat and stuff. I just really, that's really lovely. I know many of you will have already made a donation when you signed up for this, and already a few donations, some very generous donations actually, I will say, that came through this morning. So again, it's just very moving when people express their generosity. But we're just very keen to keep these retreats going and keep having a free option for those that can't make it. It's very, very important at Dharma Chakra that we keep the whole ethos of take what you need, give what you can. Yeah, even when I say that, I'm just like, God, yeah, I really need to keep that. Just really like that, even that saying. So yeah, if I'm going to put a link in the chat now. So if you do, if you are available, or if you do have the resources to share some more, then that's really good. But as usual, you know, the most important thing is that you come along to these things, you give yourselves as fully as you can, which many of you are very struck by the consistency of numbers and the consistency of people doing the whole retreat, actually, which is really, really good. So yeah, that's probably more than enough for me. Here's the link in the chat if you can. But yeah, hopefully see you again soon. We've got a bunch of other things coming up for the rest of the year. So, and just again, this is the last session I'll be hosting, but just want to say a really big thank you to the teachers as well, Singhashri, Balajit, and Viveka, some real quality teaching here. So yeah, thank you very much. Well on.
Yeah, thank you so much, Zach. And yeah, my sense is the Buddhist Center Online is becoming like, you know, just ever more of a resource for the whole movement, really. You know, such an abundance of talks and events and activities and things, so rich. Hundreds and hundreds of talks there on endless topics. Great. So let's hear a bit of a recap from the retreat. I'm just looking at Singhashri and Viveka and wondering if either of those looks more enthusiastic to begin, or whether they want me to begin.
available plan A, just transparency for everyone. Plan B was in case I need to go meet the repair person for a major appliance that has suddenly lost the will to keep going in my home. All right, so I'm gonna go on. I'm looking at gallery because I really, as the retreat's gone on, I really appreciate just being with you all clearly in the gallery view. All right, so as it is at the end of the retreat, it is so much has happened that we can't possibly try to recap the retreat in the sense of summarizing it in its entirety. And everything is the retreat. Everything is the retreat while we're on retreat. So even my broken appliance is the retreat. Yeah, and there's been times where you've obviously been in groups and have received profound teachings from each other and maybe from yourself. You know, you found, have to, a confession to make, or here's a reveal, maybe not a confession, it's a reveal. Like from Dharma teachers, often what comes out when you're just present with people is a total surprise in a way. Because we are, just as we co-create samsara, we co-create I want to say nirvana, but that seems so fixed and solid. So, you know, something else other than samsara. emergent goodness. All right, so I'll say that. And just one thing before we go into the recap is just to notice just how it is completing for you. Yeah. So at the beginning of the retreat, there was an energy of like launching and starting something, and then it sort of grew, and we kind of started building something together. And then there's a middle of like holding that together and letting it grow and ripen. And now here we are at completion. Yeah. So just noticing, like, if I'm as we go into this recap of the retreat, I'll say that some people never want it to end. Like I'm the person that if we were physically together, I'd like say my goodbyes and then I'd be the first car out the driveway. I'd be like, it's over. I'm headed for my coffee in town. So we just have different ways of being with endings. Yeah. Okay. Be kind to yourself in that. All right. So we're each going to offer just three reflections that might help help you land some things we were intending on getting across. So my first one is just about starting with working with the chakras and really allowing our body to find earth as a support and being held, and the theme of coming home. And coming home to this body, you know, as a interwoven in life. Yeah. So by touching the earth, that simple practice, so profound. That's the first thing, just remembering the earth. And then in working with the body, just remembering that instruction, sensitive to the whole body as we work through the chakras, just that is a, just in doing, you know, being in the body, just noticing this middle way as we journey in life. Yeah, breath by breath. Yeah. So one thing is working in the body, the central channel, just finding the earth, being centered in sensation through this energetic channel from root to crown. And then also that space, that amazing sky-like expanse in which all the experience, the more mysterious, ungraspable perspective, where all of experience is unconditionally birthed and ceases, yeah, goes into the great transition as ultimately this physical body will do. So yeah, just in the working with the chakras, all that's there. And working with body awareness, all that's there. It's the profundity of that practice, yeah. Secondly, just a reminder of the three ways of working that I think in the first full session I framed up for us. So the first one being mindfulness, and just as we're with sensation and emotion, really letting it be without having to do anything to it. Yeah, so in that, the letting it be. Which there can be both a tremendous release and learning, you know, letting it be. Secondly is to tend to it, tending, yeah. So there's more like healing and antidoting there that could be skillful and needed. And then thirdly, is turning towards and getting even more deeply engaged in what's happening. So like closing the gap of experiencer and what's experienced and experiencing, yeah, subject object duality, and just closing that gap and getting really intimate with how it is right now, being deeply with experience, the third way, as it is, coming into the deepest body, in a way, or the most subtle body, body of truth, just how it is. The body is a portal to how it is, or the body just being how it is. Yeah, that's the second thing, that letting, tending, being with. So as some teachings might say, the truth of all things is suchness or thusness, if you know your Buddhist vocabulary. This is, I would say, I'm amazed that this term doesn't exist, but it's withness, yeah, like a very deeply being with as a revealing of reality. And the third thing I want to say is maybe new, but just to say, we have worked with being in touch with our vulnerability. So that part's not so new. Like in Tonglen, a lot of the Tonglen teachings I offered, yeah. And really appreciating, I think a lot of people have resonated with, when we come in contact with numbness, how we can actually tend to that and understand that as a sensation of tenderness expressed, yeah. So I just want to say that when we're in touch with our vulnerability, there can also be what sometimes people call vulnerability backwash. I think Balajit actually touched on this, but there can be like a tightening up afterwards, even like a shaming of oneself. And just to notice that, if that happened, if you spoke out on the retreat or you said something that was like, oh, did I really just say that? Just to be kind to yourself, you know, it can happen as a kind of a flinch afterwards, like, oh. So even that's to be deeply loved. So those are my three headlines. Over to Singhashri.
Thank you so much, Viveka. It's great to hear that recap from you. So just pausing, taking a breath. Yeah, so I've got 3 points as well. I was watching my mind trying to cram as much as I could into each point. So 3 points with some subheaders. So one is, the first, which is I introduced this as the way I'm currently relating to what I think I'm doing in my practice, and I'm finding helpful, particularly in this way of working, is holding the great both and. So learning to trust more and more deeply in my true nature, which is completely open, deeply sensitive, luminous, clear, radiant. Maybe another way of framing that is my innate goodness, purity, flawlessness, perfection, whatever words work for you, while also tending to and taking deep care of this body, this nervous system, and all the ways in which I show up, which are conditioned and sometimes feel very far from the ideal. And just, holding the tension of that. And in service of that point, I invited the whole retreat at various times to notice what it's like to, rather than thinking we have to like go find the breath and focus on it, or go find the habit and transform it, or whatever we might be doing, or a habit of kind of doing something with awareness, to rather just notice that when we have an intention to be with, in that moment of, like, for example, mindfulness of breathing, we notice distraction, we wake up in that moment. It's like, can we just notice that the breath is there? So that, and that the breath is also this really helpful gateway into all that is unknown or unconscious, all the unconscious processes. And I think I quoted Lama Govinda saying, you know, the breath is a gateway to the unconscious. So it supports this process of rendering the body conscious and all that is operating in the unconscious conscious. So it's sort of drawn into the light through this deep trusting of awareness more and more, resting back, trusting in our awareness, in awareness, it's not ours. So that's my first point. My second point is the four questions. So I'm really moved by how many people found that helpful. So I thought I'd restate them. So the first is, what is actually happening, or what's here? Either question works. just noticing what's arising in the six senses, what's coming and going in our experience in any moment of awareness. And then we can make a choice about what we do with that. So the mindfulness, tending to, and being with. So what's actually happening? What's here? How is it? This is Vedana. feeling tone? Is it pleasant, unpleasant, neutral, some mixture of the three? Is it moving between them? And if there's neutrality, how is the neutrality? Is it an absence of sensation, or is there sensation there, but we don't have any sense of it, pleasant, unpleasant, numbness? And then how am I with that, which is when we begin to get curious about and open to and allow to be known fully in awareness, in the clear light of awareness and the warmth of our compassion. The habitual ways of being with experience, and we can, again, for those of you who like categorization, the hindrances might be an interesting way to begin to get curious about what's happening. And also in the how am I with that, the awakening factors. So sometimes we aren't as batted about, you know, like in retreat conditions, maybe there's a bit more joy, stillness, equanimity, energy. And then finally, what else is possible, which is where we can begin to sense into non-clinging, the absence of the kleshas, a space of awareness that's where the energy is more integrated. There's maybe a sense of wholeness, a stillness, coming home, whatever language works for you. What else is possible? To use Bhante's language, the creative response. I was going to say as opposed to the reactive response, but that language feels too either or. So maybe it's slowly noticing over time that creativity emerges where once there was reactivity. Okay, so that was my third point. Lots of subheaders in that one. And then the last one has to do with depth. Focus and breath. So just this point of maybe another way we could relate to what we're doing, particularly in our meditation practice, but also all the time, and also all the time, is knowing both how to sort of work with the awareness. So sometimes we might actually consciously choose to direct awareness and attend to one aspect of our experience, like the arising of sensations that we often relate to as irritation. So we might decide we want to turn towards that and actually get curious about what that's like in the body as a felt sense, as raw sensation. And when and how it may be appropriate to broaden, to really rest back and just let the whole thing happen on its own. And this is a way that we can start to build resilience. So in the focusing in, we see something, we get to know it. We also get to know its impermanence. We see how it moves through us. And then the broadening out, we're sort of just letting go of any effort whatsoever and allowing everything to happen. And over time, we can familiarize ourselves more and more with that. So it's not like one way of working is better than the other, where it's more like we've got different tools in the toolbox and we can play around with that in our practice and over time see how the experience changes of both those ways of working. And having confidence in how those two ways can support us and in what ways they support us. So that's me. I've definitely gone over my 3 minutes.
naughty Singhashri, naughty. Okay. Wow, this is, I hope you're keeping pace with this. So maybe we can just have a minute sensory little exercise here. So just as a little pause to, yes, Jan, it goes like that. Just a little pause to assimilate all these, this flurry of teachings and perspectives. So this is a very simple one. What I'm going to do is I'm going to put up a certain number of fingers, yeah? And then what I invite you to do is to see that and then see if you can put up the same number of fingers as well, yeah? And do the like movements that I do. And then just a little bit of warm up for the party this evening. We'll just have a spontaneous, silent little boogie. Hey, we're starting early. Okay, good. It's funny, the thought just came to me there. I thought, like, who's saying that English people are all kind of uptight and don't show any emotion? So I'll give a little bit of input. I mean, some of this is just kind of echoing or saying a little bit more on what's already been said. I will keep it brief. The first thing for me was on a bodily level, knowing your signs of overwhelm. So on a bodily level, knowing your own signs of overwhelm, and in particular the early signs of those. You remember the nervous system broadly goes two ways, up into sympathetic arousal. You know, those very, very early signs, like a little bit of heat forming, maybe, or a sense of restlessness or a dry mouth, you know, an increase in like little twitches of the feet, you know, knowing your little signs. Or if it's down, that more dorsal vagal parasympathetic shutdown, a sense that your memory's going a bit, that you're thinking slower, that you're starting to not understand what people say so easily. A drop or a collapse in your own sense of agency and things, a slight drooping of the posture, you know. And then what for you have you learned are effective ways of regulating your, you know, the this very early part of the brain to help resource it so it pulls back the activation of that survival physiology, you know, whatever that is, you know, looking at stroking some velvet, smells, sights, movement, grounding, whatever that is a huge and growing toolkit of that. Because I think this is quite fundamental in a way, because if our physiology isn't behind us, or if our physiology is going into those survival modes, then it's very hard to be curious about experience. You know, the system is very much looking out there for threat, and parts of the brain that are curious are going offline, or the interest is going away, the interest goes offline. That's one. Just secondly, around, I mean, I've just been thinking about this in the last day, really, about how, in a sense, the core difficult emotions of grief, anger, fear, vulnerability are like walls around the heart, you know. They're the hardening around the heart. They're what's keeping us separate from the qualities of the heart. So, you know, nobody wants to experience really difficult, painful emotions. And, you know, sometimes emotions can seem unbearable, you know. And they're taking us to the walls of the heart center, you know, that in life we can so easily avoid, you know. So that there's that potential of, can I come into the middle way? Can I come into and resource myself to stay with myself as I'm so close to the heart? You know, and as that capacity to tolerate vulnerability, to tolerate fear, can gradually grow, then it's like there's a runway there. Into the qualities of the boundless heart and the bodhicitta, you know. so That's that one perspective. You know, it's the stakes are high, it's difficult, very, very challenging. And, you know, we're tapping on the walls of the heart there, you know, and cracks start to appear, can start to appear. So that's probably, maybe I'll just have two bigger ones and won't have a third one because of time. So how about we just have a 1 minute silent period here, and just to kind of take stock of all that, and Singhashri, Viveka and myself will just have a little look through the questions. I mean, we might not get through them all now, but we do what we can, and any left over we'll address on the Padlet.
But how about we give people a little bit more time, like until 45 past the hour, because if we want them to chat questions as well, or
okay, great. Yeah, thanks, Viveka. Okie dokie. So it looks like Viveka is is having a fridge freezer wheeled in or something. I'm not quite sure what the appliance is, but I'm glad it's arrived and on time. It's very impressive. I don't think that's ever happened to me. But yeah, hopefully Viveka will be joining us at some point. We're going to start. Thank you for the questions. Hey, Viveka's returned. Hey, fantastic. With some sparkly new appliance to enjoy later. So perfect timing, Viveka. We're just back from the break, and I'm just passing over to Singhashri, who's going to start by exploring one of the questions on the Padlet.
Yeah, thanks, Balajit. Thank you to everyone who's posted questions so far on the Padlet and in the chat. So there was a question on the Padlet about how to stay in touch with the inspiration of the retreat. Actually, I think there were two separate questions. One was about that, and another one was about how to transition off retreat in a careful, loving way. So I'll say a bit about both. And then, I want to also invite Viveka and Balajit to chime in if there's anything to add. So, transitioning off retreat. This is something that Viveka started doing with us on retreat in California many years ago, which I really appreciated, which was an invitation to not think that anything's actually changing, because everything's changing. So, these ideas on retreat, off retreat. We're still us. We're still breathing. We still have our habits. We still have our moments of awakeness. In the same way that the washer and dryer that just got delivered or whatever got, now I'm really curious about what appliance you've got delivered. In the same way that that's part of the retreat. Yeah. So the retreat, in a way, the retreat rolls on in that, you can't erase the effect it's had. Even if you think, oh, I couldn't make it to all the sessions, or I fell asleep in the meditation, or I didn't hear any of the input, or I didn't understand anything, you were here and something happened. And that's, in a way, that's good enough, right? When I used to live in California, there was a saying, good enough for highway work, which basically means like it's messy and it works. So you're going to go back to your life. And yeah, probably there'll be some moments of messiness. Maybe you're going to feel a bit more sensitive, more highly attuned to your own emotional range. And that's a good thing. That's what we're going for. And we want to take care of ourselves in that transition. And life rolls on, and we can keep carrying the intentions of the retreat and the practices we've done into our life. So I would encourage you, there's a few things I'd encourage. One is to just take care and be as intentional as you can be about how you start to re-engage with things like intimate personal relationships, social media, work. That's a big area, work. If you're part of a local sangha, your local situation, your local sangha, and any other activities. We're going into a big weekend here in Great Britain, and people will have lots of different feelings about that. I'm planning on doing a deep spring clean of my house on Saturday. Other people might be planning on going out and celebrating the coronation of a new king. So, whatever you're planning on doing, just do it fully and completely, and just know that that's what you're doing. And also know when you start to get activated and when you might need a bit of space, a break. Some time away, a walk by the sea, or whatever natural resources you have near you. And then the other thing to say is, also, like, I think we can think like, oh, the retreat's ending, I'm losing something, but also you're gaining something, right? So like you've been given all these jewels, these teachings, you've engaged, you've shared each other with each other so much. So yeah, just like see how that's also like affecting your how you experience yourself, others in the world moving forward. some of the most wonderful experiences I've had on retreat were actually after retreat, re-entering my life and seeing like, oh, wow. I remember on retreat, I was on retreat with Balajit once, and we came back to London through London Bridge, which just lands you right into the middle of everything, everyone and everything. And everyone looked familiar to me. And it was so beautiful, you know, even the children, I kept looking at the children thinking, have I met you before? And then I thought, that's impossible. I couldn't have met this child before. So that was a wonderful moment that I gave myself a chance to enjoy. So that's enough for that one. Balajit or Viveka, anything you want to add?
Thank you. No, that was pretty full, I think. Thank you.
Fantastic. I just want to offer something that do a lot of leadership development training, and something that I really appreciated from that world is the research shows that if we practice something, so just one thing from a week like this, that practicing that one thing gives us access to remembering everything. It kind of creates like this link. So I would just encourage you to just practice one thing.
Great.
Thank you, Viveka. That's great.
And so, then can I just say something about the other question?
Yeah. So,
just to say, because I appreciated someone sharing sadness about the retreat ending and what to do in terms of connection in particular. So I just do want to encourage you, this might not be your default, but do reach out to others that you've met on the retreat that you want to stay in touch with. So the chats, you can privately chat each other. You can drop it in the Padlet. Feel free to share your email with the whole retreat if you're comfortable with that. So there's ways that we can sort of like reach out to each other to try and stay connected. And then at the end of this session, Balajit and I and Viveka will share other ways that you might stay with practice, particularly with the three of us.
Great. Thank you, Singhashri. So I'm just going to pick out one of the questions on the energy and emotional body, because I think that's a really rich area. And part of the question is how to relate to each. And I think this is actually a really important area, because so often it's seen as that there's the mental body, the energy body, the emotional body, and then the body of truth or body of awareness, the Dharmakaya. You know, these are very broad, simplistic categories. But I've really noticed that in myself and with different people I've met when when they've shared around this, is that people often have access to one dimension and more so than others. So for me, I could really easy access the energy body. I could feel the currents, the tingles, the pulses. And I thought, oh, great, I'm really embodied. And then at some point, the emotional body started to kind of come in. I thought, goodness me, you know, this is another whole dimension of embodiment that I was cut off with. And I think sometimes we, without realizing, we can almost hide in one dimension of the body. And then some people obviously are very much in their emotional bodies, but they might not have much of a physical sense of the body, the grounding or the energetic body. But I think as a culture, you know, we're very much in the mental body. We very much identify with the mental body and, you know, almost see that that's the only real body there is, really. There isn't really an energetic body or an emotional body. And so for me, you know, in terms of that seeking entry into the heart, I think it can really help to practice and open to these different dimensions of embodiment, you know, as we allow more and more into conscious awareness. Anything anybody else wanted to add on that or take away or?
A lot of the exercises we did on the retreat where I was saying, like, just dropping deeper into the feeling body, kind of relate to from a practice equivalent, Balajit, what you're saying. Yeah. So if you were there for the sections where we were just imagining taking a step back and dropping deeper into the feeling body, from the think, and you can use that from dropping from thinking into the body, yeah, dropping into the feeling emotional body.
Great. Thank you, Viveka. So I'm a little bit conscious of the time. We won't answer all the questions, but I would like to hear from Alicia, actually. You've popped in the chat that you'd like to say your question verbally. I'm just wondering, I can't see you, Alicia. Are you there? And would you like to unmute or yes. and spotlight or just unmute? Hello, Alicia.
Hello.
Nice to see you.
I'm still alive.
You survived. Great. Welcome back.
Yeah. Well, I try to keep it short to give space for the other questions. It's about, I think it was you, Viveka, in one of the afternoon talks, talking about the what's happening question, not only to ask that inside, but also about what's happening in the world. And, you know, that came up again and again. And I just wanted to say that I've found many people not wanting to make this transition in the Sangha, for it would take too long to say what all they say, but it's from keeping their peace of mind to worldly stuff is not so important. And, oh, you know, for me, it's very, I really have to deal inwardly with that, because I experience it very differently. And the efforts we've made here at the center with a few people to bring in these things, you know, it was always hard to get people who want to engage in that. And I'm very glad that Sri Ratna Earth Sangha is coming up, and, you know, there will be a June retreat in June with Buddhist Center Online from Sri Ratna Earth Sangha, just to mention for those who are interested. And my question now is what your experience is, what your ideas are, what might help bridge that, you know, make more of that connection. Because, you know, to put it in a nutshell, if we wait too long before we are wise enough, you know, the planet will have gone. And I think it's really, it's, you know, it's not 5 before 12. That's how we say in German. It's, you know, it's very tight. So I'd be interested what your experience is with that. And I wanted to raise the theme because it's so much at my heart, and I feel it's underlooked at. It doesn't work, but you know what I mean. Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you, Alicia. Such an important area, such an important topic. Thank you for articulating that. Any comments, Viveka or Singhashri?
Yeah, we'll respond. I think some of the principles we've talked about on this retreat will influence people's sense of capacity of being able to turn towards, you know, what can be quite overwhelming in terms of like climate crisis, social, seemingly intractable social problems and polarization. So yeah, people can experience the overwhelming and the numbing in relationship to that, just like we can in the internal. But I think having compassion for that. And you know, generally the body, one way to put it is the body fires on yes, like it activates on something that can be a yes to. So how to make, again, like getting out of the doom loop, you know, how to make it inviting to engage is, I think, would be the creative response. Yeah, because if people feel shamed or feel, right, like this kind of, maybe like things that are more, would bring up a no response, right? That they're gonna not want to get engaged. And just for myself, kind of resonate deeply with you. I think just being, not making assumptions about other people. So I think about the coalition of the willing, you know, and I feel like having an international space really helps, because sometimes I think in smaller centers or in a particular center, people can feel maybe not that met by the what's happening around you in your immediate group. But I love that, you know, we're opening up these spaces where we can find people that are like, that feel like a yes to what you're bringing up, and how we put out invitations and cultivate community. But, you know, I can, yeah. So I think that's probably the most maybe creative way forward. And I have been surprised sometimes, like I can have to work with my own, maybe like deep, like, why are we not getting more engaged? Yeah. That kind of, and sometimes I just have to appreciate that we, each person is trying their best to live in this world. So not to fall into judgmentalness, but more on the invitational side. Like, we just don't know what's going on with people. You know, they might be caring for someone who's quite ill in their family, and they just don't have the bandwidth. So just to maybe noticing myself, if I start tipping into like a harshness about it. I don't feel like I want to personally encourage myself to get more harsh, you know? So how can I make it more like, let's get out of the doom loop together, everybody. Yeah.
Great. Thank you, Viveka. Was there anything you wanted to add there, Singhashri? No. Okay. We've got another question. This was on the Padlet about somatic competency. So is that something you could say a little bit about, Viveka?
So the question was asking if I could say more about what that is, since I've used that wording before. So what I mean when I say that is developing skill in being embodied beings, in our embodiment. So I think a lot of the there's such a huge range here, but I feel like that's what we've been doing on this retreat. Yeah. It's like developing skillfulness with the fact of being embodied. Yeah. And the both the being learning competency around what can be difficult in our embodiment. You know, I think Balajit in his summary points really mentioned about really working with learning about how we are signs of overwhelm. Yeah, so that whole territory of learning what can be disturb. We talked about early on disturbing emotions is where this where we can suffer and cause more suffering in the world, or where the suffering in the world, where there's disturbing emotions, can get into loops of more suffering for ourselves. So there's that end of somatic competency, but there's also the somatic competency of awakening, with the body, through the body, I wanted to just read something in response to this. I was trained as a somatic coach, and this is a quote from the founder of that coach training, Richard Strozzi Heckler, and it's about emotions and sensations, right? So he says, at the core of these sensations is the energy from which our emotional life emerges. If we are capable of experiencing our sensations, it's possible to laugh, cry, yell, demand, desire, protest, accept, and love. If we anesthetize ourselves from sensation, our emotional range will shrink, and with it, the capacity for effective action, our passion for life, and the ability to sustain meaningful relationships. Emotions, moods, and attitudes are matters of the heart, not the mind. They're bodily phenomena that are experienced through posture, gestures, comportment, and a quality of contact with the world. When we're afraid of our emotions, we try to control them by shifting our attention away from sensations. This works, but with a price. When we deny the life of our body, we limit our capacity for acting, feeling, and thinking. Out of touch with our body, when we're unable to organize ourselves towards fulfillment, we lose sight of what's important to us. We're ineffective in dealing with the concerns of those we care about. Moods and emotions are fundamental to who we are as human beings. If we delegate them to the periphery of our existence, we lose our gift for delight, compassion, and commitment. So a somatic competency, we could say, is in that realm, yeah, of learning to tolerate more sensation in a sensitive way. We're actually able to stay kindly present, yeah. And then that whole realm of expression, you know, things like boundary practice, knowing what a yes feels like, what a no feels like, what a maybe feels like, yeah. Things like being able to extend our vulnerability and say, I feel vulnerable and I'm going to say something, or I have a request. Yeah. Or, actually to be able to follow the heart, as people have said, oh, I want to follow my heart, you know, be in touch with our intuition. So these are all somatic competencies that we can develop. We've done a lot of exercises on this retreat. Sometimes people decide to work with a somatic practitioner. No, it might work with you specifically. So things like somatic coaching, somatic experiencing therapy, that kind of thing that Singhashri's training in and that Balajit offers. While the three of us have limited capacity, there's a whole world of practitioners out there, yeah, as well as just all the Buddhist approaches.
Great. Thank you, Viveka. I mean, that's such a powerful piece. And I see people have been joining me in wondering if we could put that on the Padlet, but for me that really captures the the potential really of this area, to learn to open more fully to our emotional lives and all that can follow through that, really how fundamental this area is, really. So I really want to thank everybody for this session and for the questions, and to my colleagues in the richness of their replies and things. We're going to take a little break, unless there's anything either of you two would like to add, Viveka and Singhashri, just before we have our break.
I just want to say, I think there were a couple of questions we didn't have time to get to. So if the folks who posted those questions want to check on the Padlet, I can commit to trying to address those on the Padlet.
Great. Yeah, thank you. I've written them down. So yeah, we'll pop up some replies there later. Good. So let's take a break of 10 minutes, coming back at 20 minutes past, yeah, and then we'll go into our small groups. Cheerio.
Let's just pause, because I know you may have been, even with all the time warnings, you may have been prematurely ejected from your group, and apologies if that happened. Team was in the teacher's lounge doing three sadhus and laughing hysterically at each other. And it felt a bit abrupt to just be shot out of there. So let's just orient back to the larger group. Maybe take a few deep breaths here. Maybe do a bit of orienting. Or anything else that helps you to transition from four people to 38. And I just want to invite a dropping of the awareness right into the heart center and just noticing what's here. So nothing in particular needs to be happening. And it might be that you notice what it's like to have just connected a bit with a few other folks for the last time in this particular configuration of beautiful beings. So just giving a little space to what's here now and how it is and how you are with that. Okay, so I've got a couple of things to say. Firstly, about where we can capture our reflections that we just shared in the groups. So where we don't have time and we're too big of a group to do a big go around. So you might be relieved to know that we're not going to try and do a big group go around in the next 10 minutes. But we have the Padlet. So do drop any summaries of your reflections either in the chat here now or in the Padlet, and we'll save the chat and move things over to the Padlet if you're struggling with accessing it or don't have access. So those are a couple of options, and yeah, it's great for all of us to hear from as many of us as we can, and particularly just speaking personally as a member of the team, I really love to know what people are taking away from the retreat and what they appreciate. So do fill the Padlet or the chat with those reflections. And then just wanted to say something by way of next steps for those of you, particularly people who maybe aren't connected to a local community of practice or Sangha, that there are things available that you might want to connect with. So, I'm just going to drop in the chat a link to the Radical Embrace website, which is where you can find lots and lots of information about what me and Balajit are up to. And I'll just name a couple of things. So one is, and many of you actually come along regularly, so it's been great having you on this retreat. It's worth actually just pausing and saying that for those who come along to our regular Tuesday night class, Earth Touching Tuesdays, it's been lovely to have this opportunity to go deeper with you this week. So that was a nice surprise for me. I hadn't quite in my imagination worked out that that might happen. So great, fantastic. So we are starting, we've been on a pause, but we're starting a new course on next Tuesday, the 9th of May, called The Fire of Compassion. And it'll be the second course in a year-long practice and study of the I was gonna say the Anapanasati, but it's not Anapanasati. That'll be another year of the Brahma Viharas. So we did for the first couple months of the year, we did metta. Now we're moving on to karuna, compassion. So do come along, and that's a very emergent space. So often Balajit don't know exactly what we're gonna say until we're saying it, but yeah, it's very and it's also very co-created. Yeah, so. Very much, dependent on who comes along and what they bring of themselves. So you can register for that if you're not already registered on the website. And then also a really delightful offering. I think this is one of my favorite things that I do. And it's also with Balajit. So we run a 6-month online course. Some of you have also done the 6-month course. I'm seeing a couple of you nodding. Yeah. Victoria Chittimodini, probably others I'm not seeing right now. And that's called I Am Because We Are, which is a traditional saying from the African Ubuntu tradition. And that's very much actually in the spirit of this retreat. So we're looking at both internally how we're working with the internal landscape of our hearts, and then how that affects our relationship with others in the world. So that's, and it's six day-long sessions between the months of October and March. So a nice thread through the winter months. And then we do meditation reviews, one-to-one meditation reviews in between the sessions. And also there's some reading that is offered. So I share draft chapters of a book that I'm working on. So you get that sneak peek of that publication that will one day be published. God as my witness, it will happen. Yes, we're getting some recommendations in the chat around the 6-month course. Thanks, Allie. So do have a look. And that's also offered on a Donna basis. If we think, oh, a 6-month course, that sounds expensive, I couldn't possibly do that. We're really happy to, we sort of offer it in the same spirit as what Zach was saying earlier, around wanting to make things accessible and affordable. Currently I'm also offering one-to-one meditation reviews on a Donna basis. So again, just giving what you can. If you want some help with your meditation practice, you can reach out to me and we can arrange that, and you can do that through the website. And then Balajit also, I don't know if you wanted to offer anything in this space, if you had anything to offer by way of one-to-one work.
Not really, no. I'm full with a waiting list, but maybe in the future. Thanks for giving me the opportunity to say something.
So if you want more to do with Balajit, come along to our Tuesday night class. And then Viveka, I don't know if you wanted to offer anything here.
I do have room for a couple of somatic coaching clients. So if working that way is of interest, you could reach out for that. And otherwise, every once in a while, I'm leading retreats somewhere. So you might hear about that. Singhashri and I are leading a month in Akashavana for order members. In I believe August of 2024, 3 weeks, I think. Is it 3 weeks? Yeah. And it's about to go up on their website. It's on us to finish coming up with a blurb for it. Oh, blurbs. But yeah.
I have actually sent you the draft blurb now, so have a look.
To see what I think I am now, the hold up.
Do you want me to resend it to you?
No, that's right. We can spare the whole retreat our administrative back and forth, but I'm good. I have it. Yeah. For the somatic coaching, yeah, I'll put my email in here.
Okay. And then again, just want to reiterate all the resources on the Buddhist Center online and Free Buddhist Audio. So if you're, particularly if you're isolated, that's a great place to go to tune in to endless amounts of Dharma teaching and community. So I'm going to just take a breath. This evening, yeah, so I wanted to just give you a heads up about this evening. So we're going to be having a closing ritual. And in that ritual, there's an opportunity to offer intentions around how you'd like to take your practice forward from this retreat. So you might want to have a think about that between now and not this evening, in the late session, the last session of the day, session 3, the third session. So do have a little reflection, and we'll have some time in the ritual to also reflect on any intentions we want to take forward. And then we're going to have a little dance party to celebrate all of the efforts that we've put in this week in one of the most delightful ways of using our bodies. And dance can mean anything. So it could just be laying on the floor, twiddling your fingers, or it could be jumping up and down floor to ceiling and everything in between. So depending on how your body is just now, listening to music together and letting our bodies resonate and move to the music in whatever way feels good to us. So Viveka will be offering a playlist, and you are invited to bring any to do a couple of things. A, dress up if you'd like for the dance party. If you don't have anything particularly spectacular just there in your wardrobe right now, there are some wonderful filters on Zoom that you could use. Hats and glasses and various different landscapes you could put yourself in. And then also feel free to bring any furry friends, any soft toys. So any beings that help you, that support you. I've got a couple of soft toys. In fact, I've got one soft toy that Viveka gifted me in January that I'm going to bring with me. She's looking at me like, I don't know what you're talking about, but you will remember when you see it. And we'll share those with each other. Yes, Twinkie, you absolutely remember what I'm talking about. And we'll just be able to hold those up to the camera while we have our dance party and take in each other's friends. So it's going to be a wacky moment there, a wacky 10 minutes of the retreat as we say goodbye to each other. Okay, so thank you so much. So we'll end there. Feel free to make any reactions or take yourself off mute to say goodbye. Go well.
Thanks, Chris. Bye-bye.
Especially you. See you later.
Thanks, everyone.
Well,
thank you so much.
Yeah.
Take care.
Thank you.
See you later. Bye.
Bye-bye.
Thanks, God.